True Crime Brewery contains disturbing content related to real-life crimes. Medical information is opinion based on facts of a crime and should not be interpreted as medical advice or treatment. Listener discretion is advised.
Welcome to True Crime Brewery. I'm Jill.
And I'm Dick.
Today's show is brought to you by HelloFresh. Please visit HelloFresh.com and use the promo code TCB30 to save $30 off your first week of deliveries when you subscribe. On June 9, 2008, 30-year-old Travis Alexander's body was discovered by his friends in his shower at his home in Mesa, Arizona. Alexander had sustained 29 stab wounds, his throat had been slit, and he'd suffered a gunshot wound to his head.
Maybe a little more descriptive verb would be slashed for his throat.
Slashed.
I mean, this was a gaping, huge wound.
He was nearly beheaded.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think that's more than a slit.
Okay.
Not to be too corrective.
That's all right. I think that's appropriate. Well, friends and housemates hadn't heard from Travis in about 5 days. And then a friend that Travis was supposed to go on a trip with was getting worried. She called two friends who went to the house with her. And after obtaining a key, the friends entered Travis's house. Now, as they opened the door, they saw a huge blood stain. The air was filled with the smell of decomposition. When police arrived, there was no sign of forced entry. One person of interest was immediately suggested, though. Jodi Arias. Jodi was an ex-girlfriend with a history of stalking Travis. Many of Travis's friends thought that Jodi was obsessed with Travis, and her behavior could be very disturbing. Now, interviews and evidence from the crime scene would lead police into the twisted world of Jodi Arias, an attractive and composed young woman who would give police at least 3 different stories of what happened on the day that Travis was murdered. So join us at the quiet end as we learn about Travis Alexander, a young man who was brutally killed at his most vulnerable, and expose the lies and violent narcissism of his killer in this episode of True Crime Brewery, Fatal Exposure. Before we open up the beer, I'm going to do a couple thank yous.
Let's have some thank yous.
Okay, so thank you to some 5-star reviewers, Daphne Diabolic, UW Julie, Greg H. 02462, Palin Quinn, Mark Oates O. Tiger, Dr. X. 212, Lala Lauren Joy, Michigan Mom 22, A1 Elbow, and Queen Coach. Thank you, everybody, and welcome to the brewery.
Queen Coach.
Queen Coach.
Is that bigger than a standard coach?
I would think so. You've got the single, the double, Queen and the King Coach.
Yeah.
Okay.
If that's what I'm reading into it, I don't know.
Well, maybe she's just the queen of the coaches. That might be more sensible.
Yes.
Okay. What do you have for a beer for us today?
I have a beer called Coffee Kolsch, which is brewed by Huss Brewing Company in Tempe, Arizona. So Tempe is a suburb of Phoenix. Mesa is also, I believe. So we're in the same area.
Okay.
Anyway, a little history about Kolsch beers. They were originally only brewed in Cologne, Germany, hence the name Kolsch. They tend to be pale in color, light to medium-bodied. The hop profile is medium to slightly assertive, so they can be a little on the hoppy side. And they tend to be dry. Now, Huss Brewing Company's take on it is to put some coffee in it, which is amazing. What a good beer.
Oh.
So it's a light gold color. It has a faint coffee aroma, which, to me, that style of beer, I don't want to be overwhelmed by coffee. I want something kind of tantalizing me.
Okay.
Which this does.
All right.
And the taste is like a coffee and cream taste. It's sweet. And it is a light-bodied beer. Very nice beer. Good summer beer. Let's try it.
Okay. Sounds good. Let's open it up.
We'll open it, and we're going to use some glasses that are cylindrical.
Okay.
Remember those smutty nose glasses I got?
The ones that look like test tubes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So we're going to serve this Kolsch out of those glasses.
Okay. Sounds great. Okay. Let's go down to the quiet end, Dickie.
The quiet end's a little busy.
Not so quiet today.
Maybe not. You know, it's a beautiful day. I think people are just happy to be out and around after all the crappy weather we had.
Mm-hmm.
And where else to go but your favorite bar and to sit at the quiet end and listen to us do our podcast.
Sure, why not?
You know how popular we've become at this place.
Yes. Sometimes I wonder if we get annoyed.
I don't think so.
No. Think they like it?
I think so. Okay. I think we even, in a sense, help bring business to the bar, at least on the days that we broadcast or do the recording.
Yeah.
It seems like there's more people here.
Well, that's really cool.
So, I don't think we should take all the credit.
No, not at all, because the beer gets credit.
The beer certainly
gets
credit. Good
beer here, yeah.
But I think our being here doesn't hurt them.
No. No, because they haven't thrown us out yet.
No, and we've been doing this over a year now.
Yeah.
So, I'm thinking we're in pretty good hands.
Okay.
Okay. So, I'm going to start talking about Travis. And Travis Alexander had a difficult childhood. And that's probably an understatement.
Yes, I was going to say that's putting it mildly.
He was born in 1977 as the first child of Gary and Pamela Alexander. Now, Pamela was Gary's third wife. She was 24 years old, and Gary is 29, with two children from a previous marriage. Pam and Gary had two other kids after Travis was born, two daughters, Samantha and Tanisha. So the family lived in Riverside, California, which is a large city southeast of Los Angeles. And I don't think it's the nicest place to be brought up in.
No, it wasn't.
Travis's parents were both addicted to methamphetamine. They were controlled by their addictions and incapable of caring for their children. So Gary eventually left the family entirely, leaving just Pamela with, I guess, the three kids. Did he take his two daughters from a previous marriage with him?
Mm-hmm. So I believe so.
Gary splits with two kids. Pamela's left behind with three.
Right. So Travis was kind of taking care of the little ones.
Yeah. Because Pamela would go on week-long drug binges, followed by spending days in bed.
Really sad.
What a great childhood.
Mm-hmm.
No one to cook, clean, or care for the children, who did the best they could on their own. Travis actually became the primary caretaker for his younger sisters. He would later write in his journal about the frequent beatings his mother gave him when he dared to wake her up as she slept off her drug binge. He'd also recall lice, roach infestations, and repeatedly wearing the same dirty clothes. He was always teased at school for smelling bad.
Yeah. I mean, we all knew a kid like that when we were in elementary school. I know that I did, and I wish I'd been nicer. Yeah.
So the family had no income. They lost their house, and they moved into a camper in an aunt's backyard. Now, this is a palace. It was 4 feet tall by 5 feet wide by 6 feet long.
Yeah.
Would they stack on top of each other? I mean, how do you fit 4 people in this thing?
I don't know. But it was right out by the garage, and the washing machine would flood, I read. So they always had, like, this dirty wash water outside the door that they had to walk through. It really sounds unbelievable. I mean, really, pretty severe poverty.
For sure. And they lived in this camper for more than a year.
Can't imagine.
And there was violence between Gary and Pamela. Not just when they were married, but when they had separated.
And the kids were exposed to that.
Travis would remember a time when his mother emptied a .38 revolver into his father's car. Numerous domestic incidents when the police were called. After Gary left, Pamela had 3 more children. Hillary, Allie, and Stephen.
Wow.
So now we've got 6 kids.
Right.
And a single mom who's a meth addict.
Yeah.
Great. So Travis was mocked and teased at school for his appearance, for his odor.
Mm-hmm.
But he said that the things that happened to him at school were nothing in comparison to the cruel and vicious things said to him by his mother. But he actually did have some good memories of childhood. I don't know how, but he did.
Yeah.
He had a very kind great-grandfather who would visit once or twice a year.
Yeah, they'd go visit him because the mom didn't want him to know the conditions they were living in.
Right. They'd go to Vic's house. Toys were brought out for the children. He'd take them out for pizza and ice cream. According to Travis, his mother would put on a good act when they were at Vic's. And Vic didn't know just how bad things at home were for Travis.
Right.
But what a dismal upbringing.
Yeah, so he hated to leave when he'd go on those visits.
I can imagine.
Mm-hmm. Well, when he was only 10 years old, Travis ran away. He went just a few blocks away to his father's parents' house, and he told them that he was living with them from then on. So he took that on himself. Now, his grandmother, Norma, agreed, but Travis couldn't understand why no adult had intervened on his and his siblings' behalf prior to that.
Well, That's a reasonable thing to think.
Yeah. Now, Norma was a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. She introduced her grandchildren to the religion. She also gave them the structured life that they had really craved.
So were there other kids that went to live with them besides Travis?
Yes. The other kids went afterwards,
okay,
too. Now, Travis attended the church, and he did well all through high school. And although he was clean and he was good-looking and things had changed for him, the memories of his earlier life really plagued him, leaving him insecure and shy.
Well, I can only imagine. With an upbringing like that, it's amazing he could function at all as an adult.
Right. Yeah, because that stuff doesn't leave you.
Oh, no.
No. So his involvement in the church seemed to be good for him, building his confidence as he became more involved in groups and activities. He graduated from high school in 1995, and after high school, he worked several different jobs to save up for his church mission. So this is something that the Mormons do.
Right.
After high school is go out on a mission.
Yeah, they go on a 2-year mission.
Yep. So in 1996, he served in the Colorado-Denver South Mission, where he spent 2 years helping the homeless. His first-hand experience with poverty made this work especially meaningful to him, because he could understand where the people were coming from.
I would think he'd be pretty empathetic about this.
Yes. Now, when he was 21, Travis returned to California, and he shared a home with some other young, single Mormon men. He joined the Riverside Singles Ward of the LDS and was called by the nickname T-Dog. So, young, single adult wards of the LDS Church are meeting places for single church members from 18 to 30 years old. In the Mormon Church, wards are local congregations overseen by a bishop. So, singles adult wards are for singles under the age of 30. Family wards are for married members. And the primary purpose of the singles ward is to give those people a chance to meet other singles so they can get married.
Right. We have to keep the church going.
Right. So dating among church members was solely focused on finding a spouse. It was very directed, and there was no fooling around allowed.
Well, you're not allowed to anyway.
Right.
Right?
Right.
And the Mormon teachings are no premarital sex.
Yeah, or even making out or anything.
Right. They're very strict.
Yeah. So, thing that happened with Travis, though, he's getting older, and by the time you're 30, your choices are becoming more limited, and you're going to be kicked out of the young singles, and you're going to be with older people.
And the choices dwindle.
Yes, exactly.
When you're in with the older people.
Yeah.
Even though, I mean, I look at 30 and say, wow, that's still young.
Well, sure.
But
right.
I guess not in the Mormon church.
Right. Kind of, most people are married off by then.
Yeah.
So
he had been in this singles ward.
Yes.
Hadn't found anyone.
Well, he dated a couple, but he didn't have a steady one.
Right. I mean, he hadn't found the person he was going to marry.
No.
And he's starting to worry that he's approaching 30.
Mm-hmm.
And I got to do something.
Exactly. Right.
Okay. I think that might set his frame of mind a little bit.
It does. Yeah, I think that's a big part of where he's coming from. Even though, you know, Jodi did become a Mormon, she wasn't appropriate, I guess.
Well, we're going to find that out.
Right. Well, anyway, because Jodi Arias is a habitual liar, it's really difficult to get a clear picture of her life up until she met and became involved with Travis. So by weeding through the facts and interviews with friends and family, we were able to come up with a reasonable picture of her upbringing, which we'll share. So Jodi was born in 1980 in Salinas, California, to Bill and Sandra Arias. Bill was a restaurateur, and Sandra worked at his restaurant. Salinas would seem like an ideal place to grow up for Jodi. It's 8 miles inland from the Pacific Ocean, and it has a temperate climate. It's known for beautiful gardens and vineyards. And according to family and old classmates, Jodi was a happy kid who loved to draw. She was also an avid reader. She took karate lessons and played the flute in the school band. A babysitter for Jodi and her little brother would recall that Jodi was violent with her brother. When confronted with hurting him, Jodi would deny everything. And she seemed not to care, as if maybe she was emotionally detached. Now, after Travis's murder, Jodi would say in court that she was frequently given disciplinary beatings by both of her parents, and these claims have never been backed up by anyone else.
Yeah, they're certainly denied by her parents.
Yes. Although they stopped saying anything because, you know, they didn't want her to get the death penalty when we get to court, but we'll talk about that.
Yeah.
So the people who knew the family said that Sandra and Bill were very strict parents, although not abusive. When Jodi was 11, her family moved to Santa Maria, California, 157 miles south, where Bill had a restaurant called the Branding Iron. Now, Jodi babysat a lot for her younger sister and brother. In junior high, she was often seen carrying a diaper bag and walking with them through the neighborhood. As she reached her teens, Jodi and her mother had a falling out. Jodi and a friend planted a pot seed on Jodi's roof. And a neighbor told Sandra about it, and Sandra, for some reason, decided to call the police. Which, to me, that's a big overreaction.
I think so. One seed.
Yeah.
So they're going to have a whole forest of marijuana.
Yeah, and yeah. They were naive. They were just kind of fooling around.
Yeah, it sure doesn't sound like they're planning on doing anything with it.
Right.
Other than seeing if they could get it to grow.
Right. Well, Sandra and Bill had that idea, and they thought, well, maybe this will scare her straight if the police come.
Yeah, I guess that's one way of looking at it. But if she's never given them any trouble beforehand,
right?
Why would you do that?
I don't know. Well, after that, Jodi really held a lot of resentment for her mother. There were a couple of incidents where Jodi kicked and hit her mother. And when the family moved again, this time to Yreka, California, 500 miles away, her resentment grew more. As most teens would be, Jodi was upset to be torn away from her school and her friends, and her best friend from that time, Patty, would later say that Jodi was really devastated by the move.
Yeah, well, you know, it's tough moving teens.
Yeah.
They get attached to their place where they are, and they don't want to leave.
I know, but sometimes it's unavoidable.
Yeah, it is. And you know what?
What?
Most of the time they settle into the new place.
Sure.
And make new friends.
That's right. So, although it's stressful, I'm sure.
Well, I think everything's stressful when you're a teen.
Yeah, kind of, yeah. Well, at the high school, Jodi joined in the 9th grade, and some students from that time said that Jodi seemed well-adjusted and was even popular in high school. So this is a story much different from what Jodi would say about that time of her life. Sandy Arias said that Jodi was prone to angry outbursts throughout her high school years. Jodi felt that her parents restricted her too much, and her peers from that time really agreed with Jodi that her parents were very strict.
Yeah, they had some big rules.
Unusual ones, yeah.
I think from us looking at it, they are unusual. For one thing, Jodi had a curfew of 6 p.m. every night. This is a high school kid. She was not even allowed to participate in evening school activities. For some reason, Sandra and Bill felt compelled to keep a tight grip on Jodi. But this would backfire, because she quit school. Jodi quit school when she was finishing the 11th grade and moved out of her home when she was 17 years old.
Mm.
So this is like, I've had it, I'm out of here.
Yeah, and so she rebelled.
Was. Jodi had a few boyfriends throughout high school. Friends would note that Jodi could become completely absorbed in her romantic relationships. The interest of her boyfriend would become her interest as she molded herself to suit his preferences. And as you mentioned, she converts to Mormonism when she hooks onto Travis.
Right, yep.
Jodi interpreted her parents' strictness as not being supportive of her artistic ambitions. And she did have a pretty good eye for art.
Yep, especially photography.
Photography.
Yep.
She would use this as an excuse to fail her classes and leave school. And she wasn't involved with drugs or alcohol, but she did seem to have some mental instability. She seemed to thrive on drama, and in some cases creating it in her life. She gained a tendency towards lying and making up stories.
Mm-hmm.
So these are her friends talking
right.
About, oh yeah, old Jodi.
Yeah.
She'd lie like a rug.
Right, yeah. Well, it's interesting to see how that started out.
Yeah.
I mean, you wonder about that falling out with her mother and the strictness she was rebelling against. I mean, it just makes you wonder.
Oh, it does.
Yeah.
One of Jodi's claims of physical abuse by her parents was her father pushing her into a doorpost and causing her to lose consciousness. Now, this has never been substantiated.
No.
So she wasn't taken to an ER or seen by emergency technicians.
There's no record of it,
no. There's no record of it.
Right.
And obviously, the father denies it ever happened.
Well, the parents are pretty quiet, but they never agreed that it happened.
Right. So after she quit school, she never returned to high school. She moved in with her boyfriend Bobby at his grandparents' house and worked waitressing jobs. Now, she soon discovered that Bobby was cheating on her when she hacked into his email account.
Yeah, so she was already really jealous and obsessed.
Yeah, because we know that's a sin, hacking into email accounts.
Sure.
You can't do that.
No.
Lack of trust.
Well, and the whole situation wasn't great. She moved in with him and his grandparents. According to what I read, it wasn't like a great house. It was a small house.
Yeah, it was. I mean, Bobby was a smart enough guy to apologize to Jodi. He said he'd never do it again.
Right.
They stayed together. But the living conditions at the grandparents' house was horrible. It was a filthy, cluttered up house.
Right.
So, and we have another claim from Jodi that Bobby tried to strangle her when they had a fight, and she called 911. Now, looking back, many people wonder if maybe the tables were turned and Jodi was the more abusive one.
Well, you wonder after what she did, sure.
So she and Bobby did break up.
Mm-hmm.
She moved back to Salinas in 1999 and stayed with her best friend's family. Her best friend, though, was attending college, and Jodi felt very alone. So she returned to Bobby. Now, Bobby was living in Medford, Oregon at the time. Even though she would say he was physically and mentally abusive, she moved to Medford, and she started dating Bobby's roommate, Matt. Then she got a waitressing job, and she and Matt got an apartment together.
And this was all very upsetting to her parents, because they had high hopes for her. She was smart, talented, beautiful.
Yeah, I'm sure the parents are looking at it as, you know, she's just throwing everything away.
Yeah, exactly. She never did go back to school.
Nope. And here she's in with a guy who is reportedly abusive to her, although we don't know for sure.
Right.
She leaves him, hooks up with his roommate. She'd still occasionally see Bobby, though. And then she began calling him repeatedly and leaving gifts on his doorstep.
Well, that's why it kind of seemed like she started seeing the roommate to make Bobby jealous.
Yeah, but Bobby started to feel frightened of her.
Yeah.
This was a little much.
Mm-hmm.
And he was considered a stalking victim. So Jodi and Matt practiced Buddhism together. And things seemed good for them for a while. But after a few months, she wrote in her journal about how much she missed Bobby. And then by 2001, her relationship with Matt was failing.
Jodi claimed that they broke up after Matt cheated on her with a coworker. So when she learned of this betrayal, she confronted the other woman, and she made one final attempt to win him back, but Matt was done with her. Jodi had established a pattern now in these relationships. First, the man was her Prince Charming, and then he would disappoint her, and despite his betrayals, she always tried to win them back, though. She never just walked away.
Well, I don't think she could in her mind. She had to have the upper hand.
Right? I think that's it, right.
So, you're not going to walk out on me. I'm going to be the one to decide when this relationship is over.
Mm-hmm. I think you're right about that. Well, Jodi moved from Oregon to Big Sur, California then. And she took a job as a waitress at the Ventana Inn and Spa in Carmel in the fall of 2001. Now, her boss was Daryl Brewer, and he was handsome, and she had a crush on him for about a year while she was working there. She didn't want a workplace relationship, she said, but she felt that there was a mutual attraction. So when Daryl resigned from management, they began to see each other. Daryl was older, and he was divorced with a 4-year-old son. And Jodi seemed to have a good relationship with Daryl, but her behavior was odd. She mimicked Daryl's ex-wife, which people thought was really strange. She dyed her hair blonde, she got breast implants, and she even bought a car just like the ex-wife's car. She became obsessed with getting married then, and Daryl and Jodi bought a house together. So this was during the real estate bubble, when just about anyone could get a mortgage and, you know, get in debt way beyond their means.
Right. But there's a downside to that, too.
Well, I'm saying it is a downside.
Well, the upside was that anybody could get a home.
Sure, but then once the adjustable rate mortgage goes up,
you're
underwater.
Yep.
So this
That's
is what
downside.
Happened. Right, because they don't have great jobs. And
now, what did he do after he left his managerial position?
He stayed in the real estate business. I'm not sure exactly.
Yeah. And she's still waitressing.
Yes. So Jodi hoped that they'd buy this house at the low price and sell it to make money, kind of become house flippers together. And the house they bought together cost $350,000 in nearby Palm Desert. So the plan was that they'd live in the house for 2 years and then flip it for a profit. But we know how that turned out.
Well, it didn't, did it?
People weren't able to do that.
Nope.
Now, during their time together, Daryl considered Jodi to be quite mature and responsible. But Jodi did want to get married and have a family. And Daryl wasn't ready to commit. He's already divorced and a dad.
Mm-hmm.
And as the relationship ended, they were upside down on the house. The mortgage payment increased due to their adjustable rate mortgage. And then Jodi began to put her house payments on a credit card, which is really a bad idea. I'm not a money person, but that seems like a bad idea to me.
Well, yeah, because you do that and it starts accumulating because you don't pay off the card.
Well, you can't.
There's nothing there.
You can't afford the mortgage, then you can't afford the credit card.
So she's going to max out a few credit cards.
So this was very short-sighted, obviously. So then she just stopped paying her part of the mortgage altogether because she was just in really bad financial shape. So when Jodi learned about prepaid legal, PPL, from a stranger at the restaurant where she waitressed, she thought that it was the answer to all of her financial problems.
Yeah, what is PPL?
Prepaid legal. So it's kind of an insurance, for a legal insurance, like if you ever need a lawyer.
Mm-hmm.
So the company, though, it was kind of like a pyramid scheme, because associates would get paid by selling the legal insurance to others. But you needed to sign up people to sell the legal insurance underneath you. And the money you would make, you'd move up the ranks in the company and have more people under you. So that's the definition of a pyramid scheme, pretty much.
It certainly is.
But Travis was making decent money at it.
Oh, so Travis worked there.
Mm-hmm.
How long had he been there?
A while.
For a while?
Yeah.
So, but he wasn't. Jodi met him at PPL.
Yes, that's what we're getting to. She's going to meet him at a convention.
All right.
Or conference. So PPL was a very social group, and Jodi thought it was a fun way to make money. Her financial situation was worsening, but Jodi thought that PPL would solve everything. So that's kind of dreamlike thinking.
Yeah. You know, if I could only do this and make money, I could fix things.
Right.
Right?
Yep.
Huh.
And they do give you quite a sales pitch at those kind of places, too.
Oh, yeah. No question.
So, in September of 2006, she decided to go to PPL's Las Vegas convention, and this is where Jodi met Travis Alexander.
The fateful meeting.
Yes. So, I think now's a good time to talk a little bit about our sponsor, HelloFresh.
Let's do that.
So, HelloFresh, it's a meal kit delivery service that makes cooking more fun so you can focus on the whole experience, not just the final outcome. So each week, HelloFresh creates new delicious recipes with step-by-step instructions, and each meal is designed to take about 30 minutes to prepare. Now, HelloFresh sources the freshest ingredients, measured to the exact quantities needed, so there's no food waste. They also employ 2 full-time registered dietitians on staff who review each recipe to ensure it's nutritionally balanced. HelloFresh delivers food to your doorstep, and HelloFresh is now offering light spring meals and has just introduced breakfast options, too. And it's all for less than $10 a meal.
It's a deal.
Yeah. So what did we have this week from HelloFresh?
Well, we had a bread salad. Now, there's a little twist to it. I think everybody's probably had a bread salad at some point where you have tomatoes, cucumbers, bread, oil and vinegar dressing.
Yeah, and the bread's kind of toasted and it soaks up the dressing.
Yeah.
It's quite delicious.
Quite delicious. Now, the difference in their take is that you've got the bread, you've got the tomatoes, you've got the cukes. They use some shallots instead of onion, and they put cannellini beans, those nice Italian white beans, in the salad. And as you said, this is a snap to put together. I think we did this in under 30 minutes.
Yeah, and it's fun to do because I can be doing one thing while you're doing another thing.
Yeah.
And then we've got the meal together. So it's really fun.
And the bottom line is it tastes good. And I guess the other bottom line is it's nutritious.
There's lots of bottom lines, and they're all good.
They are.
They're all pointing in the direction of HelloFresh.
That's what we say, HelloFresh.
That's right. So please visit HelloFresh.com and use our promo code TCB30 to save $30 off your first week of deliveries when you subscribe. Say HelloFresh and say hello to fun.
You got it.
So, it was at the MGM Hotel and Casino in Las Vegas in September of 2006 when Jodi met Travis. The MGM Hotel is huge, with ostentatious decor and 19 restaurants. Now, Jodi saw Travis when she entered the Rainforest Cafe. Travis had joined PPL back in 2001, so he'd been in it for 5 years. And that was when he was 24 that he started with them. And he was one of PPL's best motivational speakers and a top salesman.
So it's always interesting to me. Here's this kid who had such a horrendous childhood. And I don't think went to college.
No.
And he's made a success of himself.
Yeah.
I'm impressed.
Well, yeah. I think that growing up in that environment, probably want to make something of yourself and get out of it. I guess some people don't.
Well,
depends what road you take. But
I think a lot of times it just kind of grinds you down.
Yeah, that's true.
But he seemed to have overcome his childhood. And was doing pretty well.
That's right. So, as an executive director at the convention, Travis was there to bring in some fresh recruits. Travis approached Jodi and asked her where she saw herself in 5 years. So this is something they ask.
Yeah, it's like a pickup line.
Right. If you've ever been caught in one of those seminars where they're trying to sell you a timeshare, that's the kind of stuff they talk about, right?
That is. And I always have that deer in the headlight look.
I know. You're too nice. You have a hard time saying no. But you do say no.
Well, yeah.
We don't have a timeshare.
And we never will.
No. Now, he told her that he planned to retire soon, which was pretty amazing, because he's not even 30.
Right. Mid to late 20s.
Yep. And he was very well-dressed and seemed very confident, so they walked around the casino together. So there was an attraction right from the beginning. Now, Travis invited Jodi to the PPL banquet that night, and that's an event reserved for the top salespeople only. But she didn't have anything dressy enough to wear, so a friend of Travis's actually loaned her a long black dress. Now, before dinner, Travis introduced Jodi to his friends. Speakers for PPL talked about their comfortable lifestyles and how they could use their incomes in a positive way for society. Now, there was an attraction between the two, like I said, and they spent most of the remainder of the conference together. According to Jodi, she didn't become romantic with Travis at that point because she had Daryl back home.
Right. They're still living together.
Yes.
Although it doesn't sound like the best of terms.
She stopped paying
her half of the mortgage.
Right.
That's got to be stressful.
Sure.
But they're still together.
Yeah, at that point they were.
And she felt some kind of loyalty or something.
She said she did.
Yeah.
Right. That's the thing. All this comes from Jodi, because Travis can't speak for himself. So it all has to be taken with a grain of salt.
Everything she says.
Yes, definitely. So Jodi gave Travis her phone number, hoping he would call, and he did call. And then after 5 months of getting together and becoming intimate, Jodi and Travis came out as an official couple. No one's sure exactly what went on during those months before they were official, because Travis can't tell us, and Jodi isn't reliable as a historian. So many of Travis's friends believe that Travis was hesitant to be in a relationship with Jodi. He still had feelings and a friendship with his ex-girlfriend, who was in the church. and early on, Travis encouraged Jodi to date other men. So she went on a couple of dates, but they didn't go anywhere because her interest was in Travis.
Yeah, she's got her sights on him.
Right. So after spending a weekend with Travis's friends, Chris and Sky Hughes, the couple liked Jodi. They saw that Jodi cared for Travis, and Jodi told Sky how Travis didn't treat her well, because he only called her late at night for like a booty call, and he was continuing to tell her that she should date other people.
So that sounds like some signals on his part.
Yeah.
That he's not that interested in
her. Right.
Except for sex.
But Sky was moved by what Jodi told her, and she sent an email to Travis scolding him for the way he was treating Jodi. She told him to confront his feelings.
About Deanna? So it wasn't fair to Jodi if he still had lingering feelings for Deanna, right?
Deanna's the girl in the church.
Right.
Okay.
Who he's semi-dating.
Yeah, so Sky said you need to confront this and decide if you're going to be with Deanna or if you're going to be with Jodi, because it's not fair.
Right.
Which I agree. I think that makes sense.
For sure. Now, she did. Sky ended up talking to Travis and seeming to endorse Jodi as the choice. If it comes down to a choice between Jodi and Deanna, Sky was saying Jodi would be the one I'd hang out with.
Yeah, she made a good first impression.
So, whatever, he was motivated enough to make Jodi his girlfriend. However, they live 300 miles apart.
So that was a problem.
She's in California, he's in Arizona. They only saw each other twice a month. Now, because sex is forbidden outside of marriage in the Mormon church.
Right.
And not just sex.
Anything that arouses you.
Right.
Right.
And you cannot touch certain areas of the body.
Right. Very strict.
Very strict. So, but there's a lot of speculation over why Travis had a sexual relationship with Jodi. Some of his friends would say that Travis was addicted to sex with Jodi. No one, however, argues that the sexual attraction wasn't mutual. But they say that Jodi was the aggressor.
They do, but he would call her late at night and stuff, so he was kind of leading her on for a while there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And even after they had broken up.
Yeah, they'd still get together. Yeah. Yep.
So according to his friends, Travis's friends, Jodi was inappropriate and weird on so many occasions that Travis failed to see the red flags. Jodi is also very needy. Travis always wanted to help her.
Yeah, he did have that kind of personality that he wanted to help people. And I think a lot of that probably came from how difficult a time he had.
Oh, I don't think there's any question.
Yeah.
So Jodi's combination of sexuality and neediness seemed kind of irresistible to Travis.
Mm-hmm.
What he didn't seem to recognize was how manipulative she was.
Mm-hmm.
So, and his friend Sky eventually regretted her decision to help bring Jodi and Travis together.
She did. Didn't take long, either.
No. She felt uncomfortable with Jody's repeated attempts to make Travis jealous. Jodi would flirt with other men, then she'd say, I'm Travis Alexander's girlfriend. That's weird.
She was weird, yeah.
Travis left the room, she would repeatedly ask where he was.
Yeah.
And she also seemed suspicious of Travis. She would check his emails, his texts, listen at doors, follow him. One night in April 2007, when Jodi and Travis were staying with Sky and Chris, Jodi was angry with Travis for not looking her in the eyes. So she went to bed early.
Mm-hmm.
So after she left, the couple, Chris and Sky, spoke to Travis about their concerns. And then they noticed that Jodi was listening at the door.
Yeah, she was very paranoid and jealous and odd. Very odd.
Sky said the look on Jodi's face when they caught her listening frightened them, and they actually became afraid that she would harm them or their kids.
Yeah, now what kind of look can you get on your face that would make someone feel that way?
I know.
I don't know. I guess I've never felt that about anyone.
The next day, Chris told Travis that Jodi wasn't welcome at their house anymore. He was upset, but he didn't see what they saw in Jodi. They told him there was something wrong with her. Travis, of course, thought they were overreacting.
Mm-hmm.
But he respected their opinions.
He did. He looked up to Chris.
He's still in love with her. Or something.
Something. Hard to say. So after Sky and Chris had spoken to Travis about Jodi, Travis began to notice her strange behaviors. And her jealousy and snooping were getting more frequent. As she became more paranoid, her insecurities became more noticeable. So the two didn't see each other often, but they took trips together. In photos from these trips, they look happy, they look carefree, but friends who traveled with them would say that there was a tension between them. Now, over time, it seemed that the only connection they shared was sex. Now, Travis was 30, and he was anxious to find a future wife. And if Jodi wasn't the right one, he needed to make a choice and date other women.
Right, because he's hitting that, or has hit that magic 30 mark.
Right.
His odds go down considerably after that.
They do, and he did want a Mormon wife.
Right.
So one thing about Travis is he did seem to have this Madonna whore thing happening, right? Isn't that what they call it?
Yeah.
The Madonna whore complex?
Right.
So Jodi was kind of like the backdoor girl, which nobody would like that. It's not a good feeling.
No, but she managed to consider it still that there was a relationship there.
Because that's what she wanted.
Right.
Right. So Jodi thought that Travis was the man she would marry. He had a house, he had a good-paying job, he was attractive, and he was getting ready to settle down. Now, when Jodi found emails between Travis and a married friend that she thought were too flirtatious, she cornered the woman in the women's bathroom at a restaurant, and she said over and over that she and Travis were a couple. And the woman was shocked because Jodi's behavior was super, super odd. She kept saying over and over like a chant, they're a couple.
And this woman, other than being friends with Travis, had no romantic interest in him.
No, she was married.
She's a married woman.
And I don't know what she found flirtatious. Travis's friends did say that he could be flirtatious.
Right.
Which, you know, she shouldn't have been looking in the emails anyway.
Yeah, we've covered that one, haven't we?
Right. So this woman said that that girl's just crazy. That was her opinion on Jodi.
Yeah, that's succinct and true.
So maybe in part because of what Sky and Chris had said to Travis, he and Jodi were broken up 2 months later. But they would continue to see each other secretly, while Travis continued to look for other women to date as wife material.
Right. And you mentioned this earlier. This is the proverbial booty call.
Right.
You know, come on over, we'll fuck.
Right.
Maybe he didn't say it that way.
He might have. No.
Yeah, they did a lot of kinky
stuff. They did a lot
stuff.
Of the phone sex, yeah.
Yeah.
So less than 1 month after they broke up, Jodi moved to Mesa, near Travis. So Travis may have discouraged her from moving near him, but she tried to get him back by having sex with him.
That's pretty interesting. The whole time they're together, they're 300 miles apart.
Right.
And they break up and she moves to his town.
I know, right? And that's kind of a pattern she had. After she broke up with Bobby, she went and moved closer to him.
Yep.
Very strange. And also, Jodi got baptized and converted to Mormonism back in November of 2006. And she joined a different LDS ward from Travis to avoid the awkwardness. So that was good.
At least she recognized that.
Mm-hmm.
But did she feel like if I convert to Mormonism, that's something in my favor? Maybe it'll help win him back?
Well, yeah, I think that that would make her wife material in her head. But it wasn't enough for him.
No.
No. So Travis began to date another woman, Lisa Andrews, after he broke up with Jodi. Now, Lisa was only 19, and she was a nice Mormon girl who Travis thought would be the perfect wife. But Lisa wasn't ready for a commitment. She was 19.
Well, yeah. Plus, now he's 30, right?
Right, right.
And I know, 11 years. But I think a 19-year-old and a 30-year-old, that's a big gap.
It is. It is. I agree. Because those are just such different points of life.
Right.
Yeah. Like if she was 40 and he was 51, that'd be different.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, Travis gave Jodi access to his house so that she could clean it. And according to Jodi, Travis had offered to pay her $12 an hour to do the cleaning. But then some friends of Travis had said that Jodi offered to do it for free. And she'd just come over and do it without asking, just so she could be near Travis. So now that Jodi's in Mesa, the two have had sex more often. It's impossible to know who was instigating these meetings. Still, Travis continued to date Lisa also. Now, Lisa and Jodi, I don't even know if I need to say this, but they were very different.
I think so. Because I'll bet he wasn't having sex with Lisa.
No, Lisa was a virgin and she adhered to the church's laws of chastity.
Right.
Lisa felt guilty if she had kissed Travis. And if he got an erection, she would get angry at him. Because she thought he could control that.
Well, you can't.
Well, she didn't know. She was very naive. Now, Travis confided to a male friend that he was still very attracted to Jodi, but he didn't think that was enough to make her a wife for him. So Lisa was more of the wife material in his eyes. She represented what he wanted for his long term, to have a family with.
Yeah, just one problem. She's not ready for that kind of relationship.
Right. So Lisa became concerned that Travis continued to communicate with Jodi. When she learned from one of his former roommates that he'd been having sex with Jodi, she broke up with him. Lisa thought that she and Travis were exclusive, but they weren't, and he wasn't supposed to be having sex at all.
Yeah. I mean, that's the two-strike thing.
Right.
I mean, first of all, he's involved with an ex when he's supposed to be yours.
Right.
And he's having sex with her. And we know from the Mormon teaching that's frowned upon.
Right.
So, boy, dump him.
She did. And then in October 2007, Jodi and Travis traveled to the Balloon Festival in New Mexico together. Jodi had hopes that this meant they were getting back together as a couple. But just 2 weeks after the trip, Travis got back together with Lisa.
Uh-huh.
Still, Jodi hung around. She'd come to Travis's house after work, bringing him takeout. Her unannounced visits became more and more frequent. She climbed in through the doggy door and would fall asleep on his couch or even in his bed. And Travis continued to talk to Jodi about sex, so he is partly responsible for her continuing to hang around.
Oh, absolutely.
Because he wanted to have sex with her. At least part of him did. You know what parts.
Yes.
But they had phone sex and they shared explicit texts. And in December, Travis found all four of his tires slashed. When Jodi saw him at Lisa's house, she slashed the tires again. So what had happened is he had slashed tires, all four of them, and Jodi took him to the shop to get them fixed. Even though it was suspected that she did it, she didn't admit that.
Yeah.
So they get it fixed, they have it towed, they get those tires fixed, they're coming back, and he's following her back in his truck, and he turns off at Lisa's exit.
So she follows him. And slashes the new tires.
Right, exactly. Now, in February of 2008, Lisa broke up with Travis for the final time. Lisa thought he was too serious about getting married, and Jodi was stalking them. She followed them on dates, and she stole pages from his journal, and he continued to have contact with Jodi throughout the whole thing.
He's a conflicted man.
Yes.
So, in February 2008, Lisa broke up with Travis for the final time, as we said. A month later, he became infatuated with Mimi Hall, who was also from his church. He got her to go on a date with him. 2 dates later, Mimi told Travis that she only wanted to be friends. He was disappointed, but continued to do platonic things with her.
Yeah, I think hoping that she'd change her mind.
Sure. It's almost the same things that Jodi was doing to him.
Right, exactly.
Maybe not to the extent, but...
No. Well, he didn't have the obsessive craziness, but similar type of thing. Maybe if you hang on as a friend, at least you're around that person, and it could always progress to what you want.
Right. So meanwhile, Jodi finally, I guess, got the message. She moved back to Wairika to live with her maternal grandparents. Up there, her mental state seemed to be becoming more fragile. Moods were more unpredictable. Friends of hers called Jodi's parents and asked them to get help for her. However, unsure what to do, they did nothing.
Right.
So she's kind of deteriorating here.
Well, and I don't know if they could have done anything anyway. You really need...
Right.
You'd need her to cooperate.
Yep. So with Jodi gone, Travis tried to start over. He had won a trip for two to Cancun based on his PPL sales. The winners were going to make the trip in early June, and Travis invited Mimi.
Right.
Platonic Mimi. So he was excited that she agreed to go, even though she went on the condition that they remain platonic.
Separate rooms.
So not going to be any sex on this trip.
No. No, there were some rumors or some talk that Jodi may have been invited first, but she was replaced with Mimi, which really outraged her or upset her.
If that's true.
If that's true. Now, in late April of 2008, Travis sent Jodi a flirtatious text, and they sent each other nude pictures. Then in May, they had a late-night phone call, some phone sex. Jodi recorded this call, and this would be her proof of their explicitly sexual relationship. So at this point, you have to wonder if she's thinking ahead to what she eventually does.
Yeah, but she's never done this type of recording.
No, like she wants to have some proof. So on Monday, May 26th, Travis and Jodi had an online fight. He had tried to log on to Facebook and found that Jodi had logged into his account and was in there on his Facebook. And when Jodi admitted to it, he just really got super pissed off and unloaded on her. He said, "You're the worst thing that ever happened to me," or he wrote, because it was an online fight. And he told her that her grandparents would be ashamed of her if they knew, and it was really harsh. When Travis told his friend Taylor what had happened, Taylor seemed more tuned in to what was going on because he said, "Well, that's brutal. Aren't you afraid that she'll try and hurt you or something because you said that?"
Prophetic words.
But Travis said he wasn't afraid of her.
Nah.
Now, on June 2nd, Jodi packed an overnight bag with clothes, her cell phone and a charger, and the gun she had stolen from her grandfather. She rented a car and drove south to Monterey to borrow gas containers from Daryl. This way, there would be no trail of her driving to Mesa, no receipts or security camera footage of her putting gas in the car. Now, she calculated an alibi story, which would let her go to Mesa and still arrive in Salt Lake City, Utah, without arising suspicions. So she's planning on going to Travis's house.
Mm-hmm.
She's taken the gun, so what she did is she staged a fake robbery at her grandparents' house to get the gun.
Yes.
Then she goes to Daryl and gets the tank, so she has gas.
So she's not stopping for gas anyplace.
And then she's supposed to go to Salt Lake City to meet another guy from PPL.
Okay. But she's going to make a little pit stop.
Right. So early in the morning of June 4, Jodi arrived at Travis's house, and the two spent several hours together. The photographs found later would show that Jodi and Travis were very relaxed, very naked, and having sex, kind of a whole sex day was going on. So just after 5:30 p.m., something had changed, and Travis was stabbed 29 times and shot in the head. Now, on June 9, 2008, around 10:30 p.m., officers responded to a 911 call at Travis's house. Travis had been found dead in his shower. Now, officers found him crumpled and decomposing, propped up in his shower stall.
Yeah, he'd been dead for, what, 5 days?
Yeah.
Yeah.
There was no doubt that it had been days since his murder. He had a large laceration to his throat from ear to ear. No laceration might not cut it either, because it was more than a laceration.
Right.
Although they do say ear to ear. But I think the depth of it was just very disturbing.
Well, it was.
Because it was cut, the throat was cut ear to ear, cutting all the way through to the spine.
Yeah.
So,
carotids, jugular veins, trachea. Muscles, trachea, everything.
Vicious.
Yeah, this was a hateful crime.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of anger.
Well, in addition to all the stab wounds, we had the gunshot wound to the head.
Yeah, I think we read someplace that by the time she shot him in the head, he was already dead.
Yeah, yeah.
So that was just more gratuitous stuff.
Although her story in court would be that she shot him first to protect herself, and he kept coming at her.
Yeah.
Now, Travis's two boarders, he had two guys sharing his house with him, hadn't seen Travis for 5 days, but they didn't think much of it. He was often off traveling for work, and they knew that he had a trip to Cancun coming up. That doesn't really explain the smell.
No, it doesn't.
Why they didn't notice the smell, I don't know. It had to be horrible.
It must have been, you know? And I think, again, we read or watched something where they thought it was his dog making a mess. Although, I think...
That's a very distinct smell, but if you didn't know any better...
I guess. I mean, they didn't do it, so.
No, they didn't have anything to do with it.
I think feces smells a lot different than decomposing bodies.
Yeah, of course it does.
So we know that his friend Mimi was planning to travel with Travis to Cancun the next day.
Right.
So he's already been dead a few days. She hadn't heard from him in several days and finally come to check on him. Earlier, she had come to his house and knocked, but no one answered. So she went and got two friends to come back to the house with her to look for Travis. So they entered the house, they saw a large amount of blood right in the entryway. Then they saw the gruesome crime scene in the bathroom.
Right.
And I think that's Mimi's voice on the 911 call that we started the show with.
There are a couple different people that got on the phone.
Yeah, but the female voice.
Mm-hmm. There was also, now I'm thinking, well, how come the roommates didn't worry about who's taking care of the dog if they didn't see Travis in 5 days? Where was the dog?
I know.
So that's something I wonder about, which just occurred to me now. Also, I think it's important to point out that he had like a master suite and all the stuff happened there, not in the main house that he shared with the other people.
Right. So, and he would spend time in that suite.
Yes.
So it wasn't like they all hung out together.
No.
And did bro things.
Right.
So maybe they would go for days without seeing each other.
Yeah.
So that part wasn't unusual.
No. He had his own bathroom in there and everything. So outside of that, there were no signs of anything, and except, you know, the odor.
Right. So they get in, there's blood. They saw the crime scene in the bathroom. They called 911. Homicide detectives were there by midnight. Blood was everywhere in Travis's suite. All the bedding had been removed. There was a bloody handprint on the wall. The washing machine was checked, and there was bloody linen and a camera, which had gone through a wash.
With bleach.
Right. Didn't take all the blood out.
So if you're going to all that work to clean things up, why would you leave a bloody handprint on the wall? And why would you leave the camera in the washing machine anyway?
Right.
Why wouldn't you take it with you?
That would be easiest. I mean, I'm assuming she figured that it goes through the wash cycle and it'll destroy anything in there.
But it still looks curious that it's even there.
Yeah, doesn't
right?
it?
It's just causing more problems. So, I mean, obviously she wasn't thinking super clearly, maybe, although it did seem planned out and very cold-blooded.
I think it was premeditated just from her actions prior to arriving in Mesa.
Absolutely.
So the police interviewed Travis's friends, and they were quickly eliminated as suspects. Jodi was brought up right away as someone detectives should talk to.
Well, yeah, even you could hear in the 911 call, they already brought her up.
They brought her up in that call. People described her as a stalker. Mimi was very afraid of her, even though she'd never met her. Just her reputation preceded her.
Yeah.
Next morning, Detective Flores learned that Jodi Arias was trying to get in touch with him, so he called her. She was very forthcoming with details of her life and her relationship with Travis. She said that their breakup was amicable, but they continued to be sex buddies. The last time she'd seen Travis, she said, was in April, before she moved back to California. She hadn't been back to Mesa since her move.
Right, that was her first story.
That's my first story.
Right.
On June 16th, the detectives got a call from a friend of Travis's from PPL. This friend had seen Jodi on June 5th in Salt Lake City. Jodi had been there with Ryan Burns, who also worked for PPL.
Yeah, that's the guy she was going to meet there.
In Salt Lake.
Mm-hmm.
So according to Ryan, Jodi had left California on June 3rd, but didn't arrive in Salt Lake until June 5th. He had lost contact with her for more than 24 hours during her drive. Now, the drive from Northern California to Salt Lake City should be about 10 hours, but Jodi had been traveling for 2 days.
Well, she said that she pulled over and napped.
Yeah.
Then she said she got lost.
Yeah. But the timeline certainly is concerning.
Oh, absolutely. It didn't really, even if you stop and sleep, it's not going to take you 2 days.
Yeah. That's right.
Right.
So this friend wondered if Jodi had taken a detour to Travis's house. And she also told detectives that Jodi had been very clingy with Travis. Then at the conference itself in Salt Lake City, Jodi seemed to be acting oddly, and she had dyed her blonde hair dark brown.
Yeah, so renting the car and dyeing her hair seemed like ways not to get noticed.
Yeah.
They had a dinner while she was there with the group from the PPL on June 5th, and this friend noticed that Jodi had Band-Aids on some of her fingers on both hands. And when she was asked what she did to her hands, Jodi said that she was a bartender, so she often cut her hands, which seems strange.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What are you going to cut your hands on?
I guess if you're breaking a lot of glasses.
Yeah. Then you wouldn't be a bartender very long, would you?
No, not with bloody fingers.
Yeah. I'll have a Bloody Mary, please.
Yeah. When detectives learned that Jodi was in Mesa for Travis's memorial service, they asked her to stop by for follow-up questioning at the police station. Now, Jodi declined, saying that she wasn't comfortable talking to them until she consulted an attorney, although she'd already spoken to them on the phone.
Right. Voluntarily.
Yes, she'd called them.
Right.
So on MySpace, remember MySpace?
Vaguely.
Jodi posted a photo gallery of Travis, and most of the photos were of Travis and Jodi together. Travis's close friends were convinced, though, that Jodi had killed Travis, and they were really offended by the posting of the pictures.
Well, yeah. They're pretty offensive.
Yeah. If you're the one, that takes some nerve.
Doesn't it?
Yeah.
This is a memorial service for him.
Mm-hmm.
And she's in all or most of the pictures.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Now, one piece of evidence that detectives were going over was the activity on Travis's cell phone. At 11:48 p.m. on June 4th, Jodi had left a cheery, casual-sounding voicemail for him, where she apologized for not being able to stop by and see him, and she invited him to come and see a play with her and her friend in July.
Alibi.
Yeah. So she leaves his house and makes this call. She thought she was pretty clever. Now, the big break in the case was the memory card in the camera that had gone through the wash. Police were able to recover several photos from it. Deleted photos were of Travis posing in the shower. One of the last photos of him alive was the one where he's staring intently through the shower stall. Now, 44 seconds later, there was a blurry photo of the bathroom ceiling that was snapped, and it's thought that that was taken by accident when Travis was attacked. 1 minute later, there's another photo taken by accident, which shows Travis on his back with blood covering his head and his shoulders. And this photo also showed the right pant leg and foot of the killer, who may have been about to move the body. Now, the murderer was wearing dark socks and blue sweatpants, and the last photo, which was upside down, was snapped 1 minute and 16 seconds after that one, and it showed the hallway floor and baseboard covered in blood. Now, the photos from that day had started at 1:40 p.m. There were 4 nude photos of Jodi in graphic positions. There were 2 of Travis nude on the bed also. And this proved that the two were together that day, close to the time of the murder. So this destroyed Jodi's alibi story of getting lost on her way to Salt Lake City. Not that it was really working anyway.
No.
But this put an end to any possibility of it being true.
Mm-hmm.
Now, back on May 28th, there'd been a burglary at Jodi's grandparents' house where she was living, and among those missing items was the .25 caliber automatic Colt pistol, which was never recovered. So police believed that Jodi had taken the gun. A shell casing from the spent .25 caliber round was found near Travis's body at the murder scene.
The crime lab had tested the palm print on the wall of the murder, and it had both Jodi and Travis's DNA. So things are closing in on Miss Arias.
Yes, they are.
Jodi was interviewed by police on July 16th. Footage of her in the interrogation room was truly bizarre.
Wasn't it, though?
She stretched, spoke to herself, even did a headstand against the wall.
Yeah, and she was worried about her makeup.
In Jodi's first interview, she claimed she hadn't been at Travis's house since April.
Right.
Now, when she was confronted with the photos from the memory card, the next day, Jodi told a news story. There had been 2 intruders in ski masks who killed Travis and let her go on the condition she didn't go to police.
Yeah, she said there was a man and a woman in ski masks.
Right. That didn't hold up either.
No.
So her final story was that of self-defense. She was a sexual slave to Travis in this story. On the night or the day of June 4th, Travis had attacked her. She shot him in self-defense. She couldn't remember stabbing him.
Oh, that's right. She said she couldn't remember any of that.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
She was unable. And that inability to remember things was shown throughout the trial.
It was very selective.
Yep. So the trial for murder of Travis Alexander began on December 10th, 2012.
Right. So they charged her with first degree?
First degree murder.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they were seeking the death penalty.
Yes. They were seeking to see if she was eligible.
Right. So the prosecutor said in his opening statement that because a 25 caliber round was found at the murder scene, and a week earlier a gun of the same caliber had been stolen from her home, Jodi had staged the burglary and used the gun on Travis. Claimed that Jodi had stalked Travis, slashed his tires twice.
So here we have a big series of circumstantial evidence, quite a bit.
Quite a bit.
Which is probably enough to convict someone. But then on top of that, we have the DNA and physical forensic evidence.
We do.
So
and the camera.
Which the pictures.
Which you're considering the forensic evidence.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, I think even without that, you've got a strong circumstantial case, right?
Right. Yeah, with none of the blood evidence or the camera, I think you've still got a pretty strong case.
Yes. So Jodi took the stand on February 4th, 2013. So it's already gone a couple months. Trial started in early December.
Mm-hmm.
She testified for 18 days. Wow.
It's a long time.
On the first day, Jodi testified that she had been violently abused by her parents from the age of 7. Onward. In the days that followed, Jodi testified that her relationship with Travis had become increasingly physically and emotionally abusive. On June 4th, she said, Travis shook her, screaming, I'm fucking sick of you. She said he body slammed her and taunted her before kicking her in the ribs. She said that she blocked his kicks with her left hand and showed the court a crooked finger she claimed had been injured in the attack.
Yeah, but then they found a picture of her after that, where the finger wasn't bent.
Right. Travis had attacked her when she dropped his camera, Jodi testified. She seemed to believe that she could convince the jurors of her innocence.
Well, why else would she take the stand?
Right.
I think she thought she was going to be very convincing, which she really wasn't.
That's what the jurors said. She wasn't a good witness. The other thing about changing her account of the killing 3 times certainly didn't help her credibility.
Not at all. Plus, this is such an overkill. Self-defense, 29 stab wounds and a gunshot, and she wasn't really injured at all?
Right. No injuries.
No. Because she went to Salt Lake for that conference, she didn't have any black eyes or anything, just the finger cuts.
Mm-hmm.
So in the closing arguments, Jodi's defense attorney said that if Jodi was guilty of anything at all, it was manslaughter. The prosecutor argued that the murder was premeditated, based on her theft of the gun, going out of her way to rent a car, borrowing the gas containers, and the evidence really went on and on.
Yeah.
Right.
There's a whole amount.
Yes.
Of evidence.
Now, in the trial, Travis's name was really dragged through the mud. Also, the names of Jodi's parents were dragged through the mud. So she really threw Travis under the bus. And her parents.
Right. Well, she's trying to save herself.
Right.
She'll do whatever it takes.
Yeah, but it's ironic because one of the things she said is that she didn't want to hurt Travis's name, and that's why she didn't say it was self-defense right away, because she was trying to, you know, save his reputation.
Yeah, but that went out the window.
Right.
You know, I'll do whatever it takes.
Yeah. So probably the most damning evidence was the photos that were in the camera in the washing machine.
Yeah, they for sure didn't help her.
No. On May 8, 2013, after 15 hours of deliberation, Jodi Arias was found guilty of first-degree premeditated murder and felony murder. Now, following the conviction, the prosecution was required to prove that the murder was cruel, heinous, or depraved enough to make her eligible for the death penalty. The aggravation phase of the trial started on May 15, 2013, and the only witness was the medical examiner who performed Travis's autopsy. Jodi's attorneys, who had asked repeatedly to step down from the case, gave only brief opening statements and closing arguments, in which they said that the adrenaline rushing through Travis's body may have prevented him from feeling much pain during his death. So that might have made it less cruel.
So it was less cruel?
Yeah.
Please.
That's really lame. But I think even they knew it was lame.
Yeah. And I didn't know they had tried to get themselves excused from the case.
Yeah.
They must have thought, wow, this is a real loser.
Yeah.
We're not going to win this case.
Well, right. Now, the prosecutor showed photos of the crime scene to the jury. And then what he did is he paused for 2 minutes of silence to show how long it took for Travis to die. So we've seen this technique in other trials.
Yeah, very effective.
Yeah, because you really can see that 2 minutes can be a really long time.
With a lot of suffering.
Right. So after less than 3 hours of consideration, the jury did determine that Jodi Arias was eligible for the death penalty. So then the next day, the penalty phase began, and Jodi Arias pled for life in prison. And let's pause just for a couple minutes here and listen to the victim impact statements made by Travis's sisters and his brother.
My name is Samantha Alexander. I am one of Travis's younger sisters. There are 8 siblings, 4 boys, 4 girls, and this tragedy has forever changed our lives. We lost our father on Travis's 20th birthday, and our mother shortly after. And through this trying time in our lives, Travis was the one that got us through the pain and the hardship, because he was our strength. Recalling the moment that I found out about my brother's death, I think of my ears ringing, my stomach burning, and this idea that this can't possibly be happening. We have heard every detail about the crime and the injuries Travis suffered. Travis had an incredible heart. He had a huge heart. And it was this huge heart and his kindness that will forever be missed. We were robbed of so many good memories, so many awesome moments with Travis. Our lives will never be the same. We can never get him back. We are so grateful for our wonderful brother, and we feel so lucky and blessed for the time we had with Travis. However short-lived, we would give anything to have him back. Anything. Thank you.
The last time I saw my brother was Christmas of 2007. We had a really good time. A lot of our family was there. Played a bunch of family games. One in particular was the American Idol. Travis kept beating everyone. The only way I could actually beat him was by singing a Kelly Clarkson song in a girl voice so I could hit all the notes. We had nicknames for each other, Stevis and Travis. So we said, Stevis, it doesn't count because it's a girl song. I tend to disagree. He got to meet my daughter and hold her for the first time. He said, she was the most beautiful little girl he's ever seen. I never would have thought that would be the last time that I would see him. The nature of my brother's murder has had a major impact on me. It's even invaded my dreams. I have nightmares about somebody coming at me with a knife and then going after my wife and my daughter. When I wake up, I cannot establish what is real, what is a dream. I've even gone through the house searching through rooms, shaking my family to wake them up to make sure that they are alive. My wife has woken me up out of nightmares because I was screaming in my sleep. It may sound childish, but I cannot sleep alone in the dark anymore. I've had dreams of my brother all curled up in the shower, thrown in there, left to rot for days, all alone. I don't want these nightmares anymore. I don't want to have to see my brother's murderer anymore. I don't want to hear his name dragged through the mud anymore. I've been hospitalized several times for ulcers and came very near to death. I've been on several different antidepressants. Unfortunately, none of them really worked. I wasn't able to be the husband my wife deserved. I distanced myself from everybody. My wife and I ultimately, we separated 2 years ago. And this was for a period of two years. My poor little girl had to be passed back and forth every week. And now, yet again, I have to be away from my wife and my child. It has been over 4 months now. I go home to California during the weekends. Every time I have to come back to Arizona, I see my little girl cry and beg me not to go. cannot wait for this to end so that we can all get back to our lives. Travis used to write out his day on a flashcard. The last one he wrote said to call Steve. I never got that call.
Travis was our strength. Our constant beacon of hope. Our motivation. And his presence has been ripped from our lives. His giving spirit, his determination for accomplishment, and his endless strength as the foundation of our family has been taken from us and never can be replaced. The pain, the agony, the screams and fear that Travis must have felt when he was brutally being taken. We have been at this trial every day since it started. We have heard every detail about the crime and the injuries Travis suffered. I am a police officer, and some of these photos are more gruesome than I've ever seen in my 11 years of law enforcement. Our minds are permanently stained with the images of our poor brother's throat slit from ear to ear. Our minds are stained with the image of Travis's body slit dead in the shower. Our family has borne the burden of extreme loss and financial hardship to be here, to see that Travis is not forgotten, and to ensure that his life was not lost in vain.
I am one of Travis's little sisters, the one closest in age to him. I didn't want to be the girl whose brother was brutally murdered. I didn't want to sit here day in and day out hearing the details of my brother's body being tortured. I have prayed every single day before court that she would just come clean and tell the truth. This person who once said she couldn't think of anyone that didn't love Travis, that if she killed Travis, she would beg for the death penalty. The one who wrote in her journal that the person that did this sickening crime deserved a needle in their arm. What happened to that? What happened to that, Jodi?
We attempted to plea with Jodi by sparing the death penalty and trade for natural life and no appeals. She would not budge. That is the only reason we all had to go through this again.
The last time I saw him, I think back about that last conversation we had about death.
Ironically, before Travis left my house that day, we got into a crazy discussion about the deaths we've endured at such a young age. We both shared the fear of losing another family member. I told him I probably couldn't handle it. I think about how horrible and sick I got when we were talking about it. Little did I know, just a couple weeks later, my entire life would be turned upside down.
Travis was not only my brother, but we were really close friends. When we got married, instead of having a daddy-daughter dance, I had my dance with him. He wanted to get married. He wanted a family. It devastates me that my kids will never get to play with his kids, that they can't grow up together.
With great sacrifice and pain to myself, I've done my best to block my brother from my life. I don't want to remember him anymore. Because it hurts too much to remember him alive. I hate that she has taken my past of my brother and also my future. The memories of him, give her the max sentence that you possibly can give her because she deserves nothing more.
Well, those are just so difficult to listen to. It's so sad. Such a tragedy. It's hard to believe that Jodi sat there listening to these and pretty much had a straight face, a flat affect, as though she was just someone watching, like it didn't concern her or have anything at all to do with her.
Now, this sentencing phase ended in a hung jury and a mistrial was declared. So then in April of 2015, the sentence was determined by the judge and she was sentenced to life in prison without the possibility of parole.
Okay. So they figured they weren't going to get the death penalty.
Right.
Reinstated.
Yes. Yep.
So they went with life without parole.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Now, as of 2016, Jodi's at the Arizona Department of Corrections in Perryville. And another interesting thing is the cost of her trial was estimated at $3 million.
Yeah, it went on forever.
It did. Now, initially, she had said that she'd rather get the death penalty than spend life in prison. But then she changed her mind at the end there.
Well, yeah. I'll do anything to stay alive, right? And as long as you're alive, there's a possibility that something can happen.
I suppose, but I think if you had a conscience, you might not want to.
Well, I don't think we've seen any evidence that she has any kind of conscience or feelings of guilt.
That's true. Yeah. Okay. You want to mention anything else about that case?
No.
This is like a very well-known case.
Very.
But it's very brutal, especially for a woman to do, I think.
Well, yeah. I mean, just the throat injury itself.
Yeah. Bad.
Forget the fact that she stabbed him, what, 29 times or whatever it was?
Right.
That's brutal enough. But to slash a throat with enough force that you nearly sever the head, I mean, that's just vicious beyond belief.
Yeah. I just wonder if he said something to her right then. But then I remember, no, because it was premeditated. Doesn't matter what he said.
Right.
She'd been planning it all along.
Yeah.
So I wonder if she planned on having sex with him when she got there, or if she was just going to go kill him. But then he was happy to see her, maybe, and got flirtatious, and one thing led to another. So she put off the killing until post-coital killing?
Well, we will never know, but that doesn't sound like it's too unbelievable.
No.
You know?
No.
He hadn't seen her for a while.
Right.
She shows up. He's always been interested in having sex with her.
That's true.
And she shows up at his door. He doesn't know that she's there to kill him. He thinks, wow, get it on. And they did.
Yeah, they definitely did. But the thing is that she was complaining that it meant nothing to him and he was using her. But clearly it didn't mean much to her either if she was willing to go ahead and kill him.
Yeah. If she's going to have sex first and then for dessert, I'm going to kill him.
It's unbelievable,
yeah,
really.
Isn't
yeah,
it
is. Okay, well, before we go to feedback, I'd just like to mention our premium feed benefits we have for the members of Team Tiegrabber. If you sign up at tiegrabber.com, first you're going to get a nice gift to show your True Crime Brewery pride. A sticker, a wallet-friendly bottle opener, or a TCB snifter. And then you'll have access to episodes of TCB made for members only. Now, coming up, we will be releasing an episode on the Massachusetts case of Bella Bond. This is a trial that's currently happening where Bella's mother's boyfriend is on trial for murdering the child. Now, the mother already took a plea deal and she's testifying against him. So it's expected that she will incriminate him, although it could go the other way and he might get off because they really don't have any physical evidence that he did anything.
No, they don't. This is a he said, she said situation.
Right. And then after that, we're going to begin to release our episodes on the murders of Nicole Brown and Ron Goldman and the trial of O.J. Simpson. So the first episode will be prelude to a murder, or
yes.
Prelude to murder. Haven't decided exactly.
Well, it's more than one murder, so you could just say prelude to murder.
Right. So I'm thinking the first episode, we're going to learn about the backgrounds of everybody, the marriage between O.J. and Nicole, what Ron was doing in his life. And then the second episode, we'll go over the murder in details. Third episode will be all about the trial. And then the fourth episode, we're going to talk about the aftermath and the effects on society of the O.J. trial. And maybe how society affected the O.J. trial as well.
Yeah, it'll be good.
And Adam, who does the O.J. tour in Brentwood, will be talking with us, which will be interesting because he meets people all the time who are still interested in this case, even though it's over 20 years old now.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of people weren't even alive then.
Exactly.
So if you enjoy these podcasts, you might decide you want to join Team Tiegrabber and get access to more. Also, we always appreciate 5-star reviews on iTunes. And while you're there, make sure that you subscribe. To stay up to date on what's out and what's in the works, you can follow us on social media. We're on Twitter at Tiegrabber Pods, Instagram, Tiegrabber Podcasts, and we're also on Facebook. So let's have a little music, and then I've got some great feedback today.
Oh, good.
There ain't nothing I can do, or nothing I can say. There that folks don't criticize me, but I'm going to do just as I want to anyway, and don't care just what people say. If I should take a notion to jump into the ocean, ain't nobody's business if I do. If I go to church on Sunday, then cabaret all day Monday, ain't nobody's business if I do. If my man ain't got no money, and I say take all of mine, honey, ain't nobody's business if I do.
Welcome to feedback.
So I get to go first.
You do.
Ah, thank you. So first I have an email from Kathy in Illinois regarding guilt by association, the felony murder rule. So Kathy says, in your recent episode, you told the story of two teenage boys who broke into a house because they knew the owner wasn't home. One boy was shot and killed by a person sleeping there, and the other boy faced murder charges. So I agree that the felony murder rule should be given a second look. As much as those committing felonies deserve harsh punishments, and the felony murder rule is designed as a deterrent, in too many cases young lives are thrown away forever. This law has also come into play close to my home. In 2014, an off-duty police officer was held up by three teens at a gas station on South Cottage Grove Avenue. The officer shot and killed one offender. The other two were fled the scene, apprehended, and charged with first-degree murder. The offender who died had a long rap sheet, with crimes dating back to when he was 10 years old. And his buddies were also, maybe not career criminals, but had been in trouble with the law.
Yeah.
Certainly these three offenders deserve punishment. However, it is difficult to be comfortable with teenagers sentenced to prison for two or three decades when the intent to murder wasn't present.
Exactly.
Which we've said.
Right.
In the newspaper report, Marsha Levick, deputy director of the Juvenile Law Center in Philadelphia, said, changing the rule is a major concern for the juvenile justice reform movement. The time is now to examine applying this doctrine to kids, Levick said. When you have someone being charged and held accountable for the murder of someone who died at the hands of a third party, that's felony murder in the extreme. But as applied to children, you can just multiply the absurdity. Right.
Okay.
Tough issue. Criminals put themselves at the mercy of the law. However, it's time to review the felony murder rule in order to salvage young lives.
Yeah, I think so.
Well, we certainly agree with Kathy.
Although a lot of people have written in and said, you know, you break into a house, you're taking your chances. You should know something might happen. So a lot of people are hardcore on this and don't see the problem with it.
Well, I think that if you break into a house, you have to realize that the homeowner might be there and shoot you or something.
Right.
But I still don't see how you can be held responsible for the homeowner shooting someone else, and you're charged with murder in that case.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I guess in its extreme, I could say that if you break in a house, you kind of deserve what you get.
Well, yeah, that's what some people say.
But that's not the same thing.
No.
Unless I'm doing the shooting.
As who? Now you've lost me.
As the kid breaking in.
Oh, well, if the kids breaking in have guns, I think that's a whole other story.
That's, yeah, that's how we looked at it.
Yeah. Agree. Is that the whole letter?
That's the whole letter.
Okay. All right, Kathy. I think we both agree with you on that. So I have an email from Julie in Montana regarding our interview with Ted Bundy survivor Rhonda Stapley. So Julie says, Dear Jill and Dick, thank you so much for your interview of Ted Bundy survivor Rhonda Stapley. As a survivor of sexual assault myself, it was difficult to listen to, but so helpful to open people's eyes. Survivors of sexual abuse suffer in ways that only others who have been victimized can truly relate to. Once the assault is over in the eyes of those around them, it still continues for the victims. Like many soldiers who come home from war, Those who have been sexually assaulted are prone to develop PTSD. This disorder causes frequent and unpredictable flashbacks and body memories. So those of us living with PTSD have no control over its occurrence or its impact on us. And anything can trigger it. A touch, an image, a word, even a smell. That reminds me of how Rhonda's boss yelling at her brought it all back to her.
Right. Just the sound of his voice and his gestures and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Boom. Triggered it.
Right. Now, flashbacks are not like basic memories, Julie goes on to say. When they happen, we relive the attack as vividly as if it were reoccurring. Everything our bodies felt, they feel again. Our fight, flight, or freeze reactions are activated, and we may lash out, hastily leave, or close ourselves off altogether. It is both emotionally and physically disabling for us to endure. So that's something to think about, huh?
Yeah, you know, I didn't think of it that way. I mean, I know certainly what a flashback is, but that vivid description.
Yeah, maybe I didn't really know what a flashback was. I thought it was kind of like a memory.
Yeah, but Julie says, uh-uh.
Yeah,
you're reliving the experience.
Which is horrible.
Yeah.
What a way to live.
I wouldn't want to go through that.
No. Well, remember in Rhonda's book how she had warnings that things she was writing might trigger?
Yeah.
I thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah.
She had warnings for people who had PTSD.
She did.
Yeah.
A well-written letter.
Yep.
Thank you, Julie.
Okay. What have you got?
I have an email from Steve in Chicago regarding A Taste for Murder, the deaths of Liana and Eric Duke. Now, he gets right to the point. Wow, that Bob Duke is a real motherfucker. What does it take to throw your small child and innocent wife off a cliff?
Oh, God, I know. Unbelievable.
Narcissism seems like an understatement. Then he goes on to say, my college roommate went to high school with Bob and Roger and told me that Bob just seemed like the nicest guy ever. I guess this goes to show you that you can't judge a book by its cover. Bob may have looked like a nice guy, and Roger may have been rough around the edges. But we found out who had a heart and a conscience. Hint, it wasn't Bob. Keep up the good work, and I'll hear you at the quiet end.
All right. It's a good letter.
That is. And I think Bob Duke fooled a lot of people.
Yeah, I think he did.
As a good father, good husband.
Right.
Murderer.
Well, like he said, it's a good reminder that you can't judge people by how they look. You don't know what's deep down in there.
Right.
Okay, so I have a message from Ashley on YouTube regarding Away From Home, the Timothy Pitson story. So she said, was a DNA test ever done? She may have had an affair resulting in the boy, then wanted him to be with his biological father and not her husband. So I thought that was interesting. That's a take we hadn't considered.
We hadn't.
So if Timothy had a different father, and she gave him to his biological father. It's pretty unlikely. Because why wouldn't he would get custody, he's the biological father, so why wouldn't he come forward and say, I have Timothy and I'm going to raise him? What's the big deal?
Yeah, that's true. And I don't think we have any evidence that she had an affair.
No,
we didn't. Of course, we don't have any evidence either way.
No, we don't.
But there hadn't been any whispers or anything that Timothy wasn't their child.
No. Just an interesting idea, though. It is possible.
It is. I mean, if you look at it kind of on the surface, it would make perfect sense.
Right.
That she looked up the biologic father of the child, gave Timothy to him, and then went off and killed herself.
But don't you think that that's not giving much credit to the police? That they would have been able to figure that out?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. Because she would have had the number on her phone or something.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, it's interesting. And then I have Samantha on Facebook who left a comment on the Lacey Spears story, Munchausen by Proxy. So Samantha says, I was listening to your podcast again the other day about Lacey Spears. In the podcast, you said that women who took an unusual interest in children are odd. Here's a story. I babysat a boy starting at 6 weeks of age. I had him multiple times a week. I picked him up from daycare, and I dropped him off. I fed him, bathed him, clothed him. I bought him toys and Christmas presents. People used to tell us what a beautiful child we had. He called my husband Daddy sometimes. I thought of him as a son, but I would correct people. When I became pregnant, he was getting to be a bit too much, so I didn't have him over as much. On December 15th, 2002, he was murdered. I felt like I was dying. So just because some women take care of other people's children, do not lump them together. Perhaps if I had had him that night, he would still be here.
Well, that's a lot to digest.
Isn't it?
I mean, I'm not sure we said that women who take an unusual interest in children are suspicious.
I don't know. I mean, we might have said something like that when we were thinking about her right out of high school. She had, like, her apartment made up like a nursery.
Yeah.
We said that was
odd. That's not the same thing.
No. And, of course, Lacey was putting pins in their ears and doing horrible things. And she was going out of her way to tell people it was her child. So it's very different.
So I think there's a difference there.
Yeah. So if that was misunderstood, I apologize. Because it seems like you gave a lot of love and care to this young boy. And I don't think that's weird.
That part isn't. No.
No.
And I can certainly see feeling extreme sorrow for what happened to the child and thinking, what if?
Well, it doesn't say here why she had the child so much.
Yeah.
Makes me wonder if there was stuff going on in the household, because then the baby's murdered.
Yeah.
So, seems like there was a lot going on in that child's household.
It does.
That she was protecting him from. And then when she couldn't protect him anymore, this happened.
And the other thing was that she stopped seeing him as much because of the behavior issues or something.
Like no, that. Because she had a baby.
Right. But she said something that there was some...
It was getting to be a bit too much.
He was getting... So, okay. I guess I read more into that.
You could. I mean, it could mean that, but I just read it as...
Now
she's
that she
pregnant
has,
and having her own baby.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that got to be too much.
Right,
to
right.
To take care of this other child, too.
That's what I thought.
Yeah. I mean, when you first read it, I was thinking that there's some behavioral issues, and she had to stop taking the kid.
Mm. Well, I don't think so. Because he was young. She started watching him at 6 weeks. She doesn't say how long that was. But anyway, thanks for your letter, Samantha. Seems like you did a good thing.
My last one. Guilt by association, felony murder rule. And then we have a comment from David Robinson about gluten-free beer.
Okay.
So, hey guys, I thought the guilt by association was horrendous. Not the podcast, but the fact that people who sometimes did nothing but let someone borrow their car can be charged with murder. If there's a reason some of us don't trust the justice system, then this is a good example of why. How about prosecuting the actually guilty instead of friends and family? And he goes on to say, in addition to having the nonverbal learning disorder. See, I thought that name sounded familiar.
Yeah.
He's written us before.
Mm-hmm.
I also have celiac disease and had my first beer, a gluten-free beer, at the age of 45. Have you ever tried any gluten-free beers? I really like Green's Belgian-style ales, Glutenberg, Bard's Tale, and New Grist. I'd really like your take on a gluten-free beer versus a regular beer. The sucky thing is I have to special order most of them as they are not readily available. So the only gluten-free beer I've had is one called Omission. I forget who the brewer is.
Okay.
And I just didn't like it very much.
No, so they can't put wheat in it, right?
Yeah.
And almost every beer has wheat in it then.
Or a grain.
Okay. So with celiacs, is it other grains as well?
Well, anything that has gluten. So it's not just wheat.
Right. Okay.
But yeah, it's difficult. I mean, I've drunk, like, again, I had that one gluten-free beer. I've had many alcohol-free or relatively alcohol-free beers.
Mm-hmm.
And they just don't taste as good as regular beer.
Okay.
But on the other hand, if I have celiac disease,
right,
I'll take it. You know?
It's still beer.
Or if I can't drink alcohol for whatever reason, I'll drink the non-alcohol or the very low alcohol beer.
Okay.
Because that's all I'm available, or that's all that's available to me.
Yeah, so you get quite a few letters about gluten-free beers, and you don't really have any to suggest, I guess.
I don't. And again, all I've had is the one called Omission, and it didn't do much for me.
No. Was it like a light beer or
yeah.
a certain style of beer?
And it just didn't taste like much.
Okay. Well, I bet that they'll come up with more stuff, though.
Well, sure.
Yeah.
I mean,
they're probably working on it.
I think the more people that would want to purchase gluten-free beers, the more the demand is.
Right.
You're going to start finding inroads and making it more palatable.
Sure. And which it's, I'm sure it's possible.
Well, yeah.
Just takes the effort. So you have to sell enough to make it worthwhile.
You do.
Yeah.
But just as an example, look at the cheeses that are vegan cheeses now compared to even just 5 years ago.
Yeah.
What the choices were.
Exactly.
So I think there's always hope that there's going to be more and more people that want gluten-free beer.
Right.
And the beer makers or the scientists will come up with ways of making them a more flavorful beer.
Mm-hmm. But for now, they're kind of subpar, you think?
I do. No, I didn't have any of the other ones that David wrote about.
Oh, okay.
I've just had the omission, so.
Maybe one time we should try them. Try one.
Sure.
Okay. On an episode, we can pick a gluten-free beer.
We could.
Okay.
And then we'll report to David.
All right.
We'll try.
All right. Well, thanks, David. Did you say anything about what he said about felony murder?
No, I think that was all pretty well covered by the first letter.
Okay.
So, all I'd say is we agree.
Yeah. Okay, so I have the last email, or actually it's a YouTube comment from Louisa, and it's regarding marked absent, and that's the case where Kyron Horman went missing and the stepmother is the suspect.
Right.
So Louisa says, I now think that Terry Horman had been sexually abusing Kyron. Her out-of-left-field mention of Kyron fondling himself and insistence that a pedophile snatched him speaks volumes. The truth is always hidden within the lie. In the weeks leading up to his disappearance, Kyron begged his biological mother, Desiree, to not send him back to the Hormans. She explained to him that it would go against the custody agreement and she'd get into trouble. This could have been around the time when Terry started making inappropriate advances toward him. Perhaps Kyron finally stood up to her and threatened to tell. She might have stopped bothering him to make him think he was safe with her again, and then settled on killing him before his next visit with Desiree. Kane was a workaholic who was in pure denial about Terry's sexual proclivities, probably because he had been cheating on her and didn't want to get caught himself. Not even 3 weeks after Kyron disappeared, Terry's sexting scandal became public. Marry those facts up with the hitman death threats against Kane and her other ex, and you have the portrait of a power-obsessed, sexually deranged sociopath. She couldn't get enough narcissistic supply out of Kane, so she violated poor Kyron and then snuffed him out to keep him quiet. So that is a new take.
That's a very interesting take and not at all implausible.
No, it kind of makes sense.
It does.
Because that is one of the cases where I was saying I don't understand the motive.
Right.
But this gives it a motive.
Yeah, Louisa's done some thought
on
this.
Yeah. You might be a little paranoid, Louisa, but I like where you went with this.
Yeah.
Because
that's a very interesting take.
It is. Because she was in this really sexual relationship with, was it someone who worked with Kyron's dad? Can't remember exactly.
I believe so.
Yeah. So she did have like a hidden underbelly.
Yeah.
So that's an interesting take.
Very interesting.
Really sad, though.
Yeah, if that's the true story.
Right.
It's really sad.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's sad either way.
Okay.
But this does put a motive to it, which is interesting. Okay. Well, that's all I have for feedback.
We're feedbacked out. So remember, this whole episode is brought to you by HelloFresh. If you enter promo code TCB30, you'll get $30 off your first week's order from HelloFresh.
That's right.
And it's a great place to go.
Yes, we enjoy it. It's a lot of fun.
It is.
So until next time, we'll be at the quiet end.
We'll drink a beer with you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you.